You're probably familiar with the massive 380mm rocket-propelled shell used by the German Sturmtiger. With both this unique armament and the unique vehicle which carried it, there is really no surprise that many are captivated by the machine. However, what if I told you that far to the east, their Japanese allies were utilizing a projectile which would make the Sturmtigers look like a dollar store firecracker? Today, we take what could be one of the first in-depth looks at the Japanese 447mm spin-stabilized rocket. Although this is not quite the normal subject for a Cursed by Design video, as it does not directly relate to a tank, I think this weapon thoroughly fits the name. Before we get into the massive rocket itself, I think it makes sense to briefly cover some of the Japanese rockets which led up to it. Bear in mind, most of this info is coming from Allied reports from during and after the war, so some information may not fully represent the actual projects. Japan was a fairly late adopter of rocket technology, and due to this, they were far behind other powers at the time in regards to their fielded weaponry. However, thanks to their alliance with Germany, they did secure some assistance from them, which can be seen in later examples of their rocket propulsion development. The earliest examples of Japanese rocket-propelled projectiles were quite crude improvised attempts at the concept, with the Type 10 and Type 3 being quite literally a rocket strapped to a 60kg aircraft bomb. Similarly, the 30cm rocket was a modification to a 250kg bomb, allowing it to be launched from a similar launcher. Interestingly, this was also something done on the other side by the Americans with a similar rocket-propelled bomb. We can see it pictured here with the launcher being towed by a jeep. Following these improvised weapons, we finally begin to see the German influence with the naval 20cm spin-stabilized rocket. As the name suggests, this rocket is designed to spin as it flies to stabilize the projectile like the rifling in a gun barrel. The projectile for this was a modified naval shell with the rocket attached to it. This would be followed by the first production rocket known as the Army 20cm and the Type 4 launcher. Unlike the previous versions, it was now a tube-style launcher instead of just a crude trough-shaped one. At some point, the Navy 20cm also seems to have received an upgraded launcher, but when is unclear. These do seem to have been used in combat, with launchers and projectiles being captured by Allied forces in areas like Luzon. These previous models can be seen as both Japan's introduction to the technology, followed by a reasonably good production version. However, you didn't click on this video for the sensible designs. This brings us finally to the massive 447mm projectile. By now you may be wondering how exactly the spin stabilization with the rocket works, and I think it is worth exploring as it is a key part of how this rocket functions. For this, let's first look at the Sturmtiger for comparison. The payload of the projectile is located on the top with a fuse on the very end. On a normal artillery shell, the section behind that would be the propellant charge, but as this is a rocket-propelled projectile, it instead contains the rockets. On the butt of the projectile is a smaller component which contains nozzles to create what is referred to as the Venturi effect. That effect is something you need to watch a dedicated video to truly understand, but to super oversimplify it, they work to increase the velocity of the rocket exhaust. Unlike the Japanese design though, the Sturmtiger relied on small nubs located at the base of the shell, as you can see here, to generate a stabilizing spin. As for the 45cm Japanese rocket, the overall layout was essentially the same, with the payload and rocket assembly being only slightly different in shape. The real change is the way the nozzles are positioned. They are set up in what is referred to as a convergent-divergent Venturi and looked like this. Essentially, this would create a spin by using various angles for the different nozzles, causing the exhaust to create a spinning motion which would then cause the entire projectile to begin to rotate in flight. This same system was used on a number of German designs as well, once again showing their influence in the Japanese development. Hopefully I didn't lose any of you there by boring you with the details, but I figured at least a few of you might find that interesting. Weighing in at about 1,500 pounds, or 682 kilograms, this enormous shell was capable of carrying a payload of 180 kilograms of Type 98 explosive. From some quick asking around, Type 98 explosive is probably about the same as TNT in terms of explosive power, so the rocket would likely perform similarly to other ordnance with that amount of TNT filler. Similar in design to its smaller cousins, the 447mm, often referred to as 45cm by Allied reports, could deliver this payload at a speed of 460 feet per second according to a test at Aberdeen. All of this would be for nothing if the projectile did not have some form of launcher. We can pretty confidently assume that this project was still very much in its infancy, as the reports indicate most, if not all, of the launchers found for this weapon were crude or improvised. The one shown in this photo was created by Ordnance Team Number 3 to test the rocket. I have been unable to locate an actual photo of the Japanese launcher, but within the file Ed from Armored Archives provided me, there is an illustration of what is said to be the complete launcher. In the British files, this design is described as, quote, similar to an ox cart. American intelligence also reported a similar design, saying it was built from a 12-foot launching platform held on four wooden wheels. This launcher also seems to have a firing mechanism and wheel brakes, as shown in the British drawing. The exact setup of this launcher for use is unclear to me, as the Allied documents claim the launching of the rocket is so powerful that it would completely destroy the launcher. For this reason, it seems odd that the Japanese would bother to include wheels on the design. Regardless, my assumption that the launcher was a temporary solution is mirrored by the reports from that time. While there is no confirmed combat usage of this rocket by the Japanese, at least one does seem to have been used against its former masters. While digging in the online archives, I managed to find this photo, which shows American troops firing a rocket at the Japanese, supposedly on Hirohito's birthday. The launcher appears to be the same type as the ones used for the test launch. This may be the initial launch following the capture of the rockets, with the other photo possibly showing the later Aberdeen tests. 85 rockets were captured just in the Manila area, which shows that this project had been under development for some time and was not just a last-minute weapon by the troops on the ground, but it is not known if they were actually used against Allied forces. Considering that a rocket-propelled projectile completely destroys itself upon impact, and that any number of other projectiles could be hitting Allied positions at any given time, there is a decent chance one of them could have been a massive rocket. Without any proof of this, though, it is merely speculation whether or not it did occur. From the testing done after their capture, the crater created by the blast of one of the 447mm rockets was similar to that of a US 1,000-pound bomb, so it certainly could have done some damage. Similar to many other things about this project, the accuracy does not seem to have been heavily documented. In total, the US conducted three tests, including the one tested in the Philippines. It is unclear if the previously mentioned birthday present for Hirohito was one of these tests or a separate launch. Given it doesn't mention anything about a test in the photo's caption, this could indicate it was a fourth launch, but it is impossible to say without further information. Either way, that first test in Manila did reveal what may have been a design flaw in the weapon. The rocket appeared to launch well and flew fine until the end of its flight, where it began to wobble badly. This was likely caused by insufficient spinning produced by the rockets and could have affected accuracy at longer range. One thing worth considering is that this first launch was estimated to be about 6,000 feet, with the latter two launches only being launched 5,000 feet. These rocket projectiles more than likely were intended for shorter range engagements, so perhaps a range past 5,000 feet was more than the designers intended. Unlike many other seemingly outrageous projects by the Axis powers, these Japanese rockets actually represent a fairly economic solution for their lack of artillery. They likely had next to no real impact on the war, but had Japan begun development even a few years earlier, could have proven to be another deadly addition to the Japanese arsenal. The outcome of the war would still have been an Allied victory, though the casualties suffered may have been slightly higher. So what do you think of this massive rocket? Let me know in the comments, and also let me know if you like these sorts of topics, which may be a bit crazy or cursed, but don't directly relate to tanks. if you're not sure what to watch next, check out the videos popping up on your screen now, or click on my channel and see if there's anything that catches your eye. Hopefully, I'll see you there.